fast. On Sunday nights, we're in a study on 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles. This is the history of Israel as a nation. That's what it is. Of course, 1 Samuel starts with Samuel the prophet. You've got the characters in 1 Samuel. Let me kind of just review a few of the characters. Of course, you have Elkanah is the father of Samuel, and he's got two wives, P-E-N-I-N-N-A-H, Peninnah, and then he's got the other wife, Hannah, H-A-N-N-A-H, Hannah, and of course Hannah prays for a son, and God gives her this son. She says, if you'll give me a son. She doesn't say, give me a son, I believe it. She says, if you give me a son, I'll give him back to you. And of course, that son that's born to Hannah is Samuel. Samuel, and Samuel means heard of the Lord. And that's in that first chapter. And then the priest in Israel, the high priest, was a man named Eli. And Eli was of the lineage of Aaron. He was the high priest. But he had two evil sons. And his two evil sons, Eli was a fairly good man. The only thing is, he didn't ever make his kids mind. And his two evil sons was Hophni, H-O-P-H-N-I, Hophni and Phinehas. And they laid with the women at the gate of the temple, and they were very evil, and God killed them. And that's when because the priests of God and the rulers were not obedient to God, then he caused the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark, to be carried by the Philistines, in battle. And of course, Eli died when he heard this message that the Ark of the Covenant was taken. And that's in the fifth chapter of 1 Samuel. They take the Ark in 1 Samuel 5. And then, of course, God brings the plagues on the Philistines. These are the characters in 1 Samuel 5, or 5 would be Samuel, 6 would be Eli, and 7 the Philistines. And then, of course, we know that the people in the 8th chapter, 7, 8, in the 8th chapter, the people go to Samuel and say, give us a king. And of course, in the 8th chapter, they ask for the king, but it's not until the 9th chapter, the 8th character, I'm just going to call it. In the 8th character would be Saul. And Saul is the first man that's a king in Israel. And then, of course, we are introduced, and one of the big characters, one of the biggest enemies of Saul, is a man named Nahash. Nahash is the king of the Ammonites. The Ammonites are what we would call northern Jordan. And Ammon, Jordan, is right up here. You can see Ammon, Jordan. That's the capital of Jordan. That's where the palace, that's where King Hussein lived when he was alive. That's in Ammon, Jordan. And Ben-Ammi was the oldest son of Lot when he had the incestuous affair with his daughters. And southern Jordan was Moab. And then, of course, you had Nahash, and he was an enemy. He became a friend of David because he was such an enemy of Saul. And then, of course, you've got Jonathan. Jonathan is the son of Saul, and he comes on the scene there in the 13th chapter. And then you have another character. We'll call him the 11th character. You have the two daughters of Saul, and that is Merab, that's his eldest daughter, and you have Michal. And Merab is promised to the man who would go out and kill Goliath, and that, let's call him, of course, you have in, before David goes and kills Goliath in the 16th chapter, you've got God rejecting Saul because he doesn't do the will of God from chapter 11 through 15, actually 13 through 15 be more, 13 through 15 of 1 Saul. Is that something going on back there? 13 through 15, you've got Saul not doing the will of God. And then you've got Jesse. Jesse is the father of David there in the 16th chapter. And the Lord tells Samuel. We'll go down to the house of Jesse. I've chosen me a king among his sons, and we'll call David the 13th character in 1 Samuel. You have David, and then, of course, David goes out in the 17th chapter. We'll call this the 14th character, Goliath. Goliath, and of course, he kills Goliath. And then after Goliath, he meets Jonathan, this 10th character. And David and Jonathan become very dear friends. Well, then, of course, Saul decides he wants to kill David. And let's call the 15th character. He's going to kill David, and that's where David marries Michal. And Michal is given to David. And this 15th character, we might call the 15th character. David starts running for his life. And you have the king of Gath. David decides to go to the land of the Philistines. And the king of Gath is Achish. Achish. And Achish is the king of Gath. And he becomes a friend to David. And then you've got, of course, you've got the other characters. Let's call Joab. Joab comes on the scene in 1 Samuel. And Abishai. Abishai and Joab are brothers. These are David's nephews, and of course Abishai is always by David's side, and Joab is his commanding general. David said, whoever goes and attacks Jebus first, and Jebus was an old ancient name for Jerusalem, he said, whoever attacks Jebus and throws out the Jebusites, he said, he'll be my commander. Of course, that was Joab, and Abishai was always by David's side, that's his other nephew, by his sister Zeruiah. Zeruiah, that's David's sister, and then you have Abishai and Joab, and then, of course, you end the book, you've got the Witch of Endor, 17th character, we'll call that the Witch of Endor. I'm just kind of doing this off the top of my head. I may miss a character too, but these are the main characters, and Saul goes to the Witch of Endor at the end of the book, and end of 1 Samuel. And he goes to the Witch of Endor, and he's about to go against the Philistines. And, of course, God conjures up Samuel. Samuel dies in the 25th chapter, the first verse. And the Witch of Endor is, he goes to the Witch of Endor, and, of course, she's shocked when she sees dead Samuel come up, and he's been dead for 2 years. Well, the next day, Jonathan, along with his father, died at the hands of the Philistines. These are the basic characters in 1 Samuel. I'm going to erase these if y'all got kind of most of those. Well, in the 2 Samuel, well, you had one other character up there. I didn't even enter in there. Abner. Abner was the commanding, he was the commander of Saul's armies, and that was Saul's first cousin. And then you can stick him in there anywhere, call him the 18th. And then in 2 Samuel, you got a new cast of characters because Saul is dead. Saul is killed in the 31st chapter of 1 Samuel. And then Saul has got one remaining. His general is left, Abner. He's left. This is a principal character in 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel. Abner is the commander of northern Israel. David ascends the throne in Hebron. Of course, David, I don't even know if I put, did I put David down a while ago? I guess I ought to put that down, shouldn't I? David is the principal character. Abner is head of the northern armies, the north. Of course, Saul is dead, and he's just a general. David is head of the armies in the south, and Joab, his nephew, and Abishai are going to have a big role in 2 Samuel. Now, you've got Joab and Abishai coming on the scene there in the second chapter of 2 Samuel. And, of course, Joab is the man is a murderer is what he is. And you find in 2 Samuel, you see Joab, you see Abishai, his nephew, and Abishai is always by David's side wanting to go out and start a fight with somebody, kill somebody. And these are two very, very fiery, hot-headed men, Joab and Abishai. David continually says, what have I to do with you sons of Zeruiah, my sister? He's always saying, you're a headache and appeal to me. Of course, another character, the only son of Saul that's left. Saul's dead. Saul is dead when you get to 2 Samuel. Saul's dead. And of course, you have Abner and David. And then you have Joab and Abishai. And Joab is head of the armies of southern Judah. Abner is head of the armies of northern Israel. And then you have one son of Saul left, Ish-bosheth. And Ish-bosheth is placed upon the throne by Abner in northern Israel. Of course, Joab plots to kill Abner after Abner kills Asahel. Asahel in battle in the second chapter of 2 Samuel. Asahel is the brother of Abishai and Joab. Well, Asahel's very quick, fleet-footed, and he chases Abner in battle, and Abner says, Asahel, you're going to catch me, and when you do, you're going to die, because I'm going to kill you, because I'm a better fighter than you are, and you're a better runner than me, so you better run the other way. Well, Ish-bosheth becomes king of northern Israel, and of course, as soon as Abner is dead, Joab kills Abner, sneaks up on him like he always does all of his deeds. And once Abner's dead, Ish-bosheth doesn't have a hope in the world. He's just kind of a pansy ruler, and he's nothing but a puppet king placed there by Abner. Well, Ish-bosheth is murdered, and then you've got over there, we're up to about the seventh chapter, and then in the ninth chapter, enter Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth is the remaining son of Jonathan. Jonathan is the son of Saul. He died with his father, and David keeps his promises that he made to Jonathan that he won't kill all of his sons off. He won't kill it. And usually, always, whenever a king would ascend to a throne, a new king from a new family, they would go out and kill all the sons of a previous king. Well, Mephibosheth is the remaining son, and he's a cripple. He's a cripple, and there is a servant named Ziba, and Ziba has inherited all of Saul. He was the servant of Saul, and he assumed the properties of Saul. Well, when David finds this out, he goes and restores Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, back to all of his properties that belonged to his father, Jonathan and Saul. Well, Mephibosheth is there in the ninth chapter. And, of course, then you have the death of Nahash. You remember, he's over there. This is a very major thing, Nahash's death. He was the king of the Ammonites over in the 11th chapter of 1 Samuel. He was the king of the Ammonites, and he was Saul's greatest enemy over in 1 Samuel, other than David. And then, of course, we see in that 10th chapter, Nahash dies. And then in the 11th chapter, here's some more characters. We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's just kind of number them. 5, Ish-bosheth, 6, Mephibosheth, 7, Ziba, 8, Nahash, and he is in 2 Samuel. And then after Nahash, we have the 11th chapter, and we have the most important case in all of 2 Samuel that determines everything else that's going to happen in 8, 9. Then we have the ninth character we're going to call Bathsheba. And she is in 2 Samuel, the 11th chapter. She's in 2 Samuel 11, and of course, her husband is Uriah. We'll call him the 10th character, Uriah the Hittite, and we're familiar with these because we've been talking about them. And of course, probably the 11th character, well, we've already numbered him, Joab, but I'm going to put him in here again because he is the one that David employs to kill Uriah the Hittite. And he is certainly, without a doubt, he is the nemesis of David all the way through 2 Samuel. He is a pill. He's David's nephew. The man, nobody is going to assume his position as the general of Israel. And, of course, Joab kills Uriah the Hittite. And then we see Nathan the prophet come on the scene. And Nathan says to David, of course, some believe that Nathan was the son of David because David had a son named Nathan. Of course, Nathan stands before David and tells him the story about a man that had one little ewe lamb and another man that had many lambs, and how the one man that had the many lambs went over and killed this one little ewe lamb and fed to his guests coming in. And David said, if you'll tell me the man, I'll kill him. And he said, "Thou art the man, David." And of course, that was Nathan the prophet there that told David that. And then Nathan, then we see the baby that's born. We see the baby. This is a character, that baby born. And David said, 13th character, I'd call that the baby that's born, because he's born and he dies. That's the baby that David and Bathsheba, she was pregnant with this baby. And then, of course, in the 12th chapter, you've got Solomon coming along. And Solomon is, it said that Solomon is born, and his name is called Jedediah. And he is the blessed of God. That's what this means. He is the beloved of the Lord. And then after Solomon, you've got, I'm just kind of picking these up. Then you've got, when Nathan says, the sword will never leave your house. The sword will never leave your house. The characters after this 11th chapter of 2 Samuel, actually the 11th and the 12th chapter, 11th chapter is where David commits adultery with Bathsheba. The 12th chapter is where Nathan stands before him. And from the 12th chapter on, that's the sword that never leaves the house of David. And you've got every kind of evil character coming out of David's family from this point on. Let's go ahead and list some more characters. In the 13th chapter, when the Lord says the sword will never leave your house, in the 13th chapter, let's call this character number 15. In the 13th chapter, chapter 13, character number 15 would be Amnon. Amnon is the firstborn son of David. And then, of course, Tamar comes on the scene. She is also a character there in that 13th chapter of 2 Samuel. Amnon is the son of David. He lusts after his sister Tamar, and he rapes his sister Tamar, and enter Absalom. 17th character, Absalom. Absalom comes on the scene, and he is the brother of Amnon and the brother of Tamar, and he is so infuriated at Amnon that he says, "I'm going to kill this man," and he plots for 2 years for his rape of his sister Tamar, and he murders his brother, and then he is exiled. He is exiled out of Israel, and let me keep going here. And then, of course, Joab brings him back into Israel. He tricks David, has him brought back into Israel. And we've got a new set of characters that I'm going to introduce you into tonight. And I want you to, these are new, fairly new characters. I introduced you to one of them last night. But have y'all got these? Has everybody got those down?
I do, yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm throwing pins everywhere. All right, now. All right, let me erase this. And these are the characters we're going to be zeroing in on. And all of this, all of these evil characters that come on David's life after the 12th chapter, when the Lord says, he says, the sword, Nathan's words, the sword will never, never leave your house, David. The sword will always be upon your life. And what in the 17th chapter of Psalms, David said, "Deliver me from the wicked, which is thy sword and thy hand." And the sword of God is the hand of God spanking David or whipping him for his sin. When you trespass the law of God, you're going to have to pay. Now, you can repent, and God will forgive us our repentance. I've told people this before. When you go out and you sow wild oats, and then all of a sudden you change your mind and decide, "I want to sow wheat now." When harvest time comes, you're going to get wheat and wild oats. You never do cease to pay for your sin. I'm paying for the sin today that I did 30 years ago. So the sword actually begins in the 13th chapter. Well, you might say it begins in the 12th chapter when the baby dies. But the 13th chapter of 2 Samuel, That's where the sword begins. Second sword. I am really. Second Samuel, the 13th chapter. That's where the sword really starts. The sword starts there because that is where, that's where Amnon looks at his sister Tamar and rapes Tamar. Now, how in the world do you get to the king of Israel when he can conquer everybody in the world? When he's the beloved of God and he's loved of God and he can conquer the Ammonites and he can conquer the Philistines? How do you get to the most righteous king that lives upon the face of the earth and you say, well, he committed adultery and murder. God wiped that slate clean and as though it had never happened. Now, a lot of people want to hold somebody accountable. That's exactly what happens with these new characters that come on the scene. Now, we're going into the 15th chapter of 2 Samuel, and we see Absalom coming along. He is a major character. He and Joab are major characters in 2 Samuel. Now, there's some men I want us to look at. Here's the real true swords that's going to cut David to the ground. If there's a sword, it's going to be Absalom, Ahithophel. Now, these are the characters. These are major swords in the hand of God. Absalom, of course, is David's son who killed his brother, Amnon. He murdered Amnon in that 13th chapter. And Ahithophel is the counselor. He is the counselor of David. He's David's personal advisor. Well, after Absalom has been exiled, after Joab, for some political reason, wanting Absalom back, after he brings him back, Absalom decides he wants to start a coup and he's going to overthrow his father and he's going to become king of Israel. But the way he starts this, this man has got beautiful hair, long locks, very handsome, very, very slick. I mean, this guy is a personality. Everybody loves Absalom. And of course, in that 15th chapter, as the people come to the king, Absalom stands outside the palace and said, my father's too busy for you. You really need someone that will personally take care of your problems, and I think I'm the man to do that. So he begins to charm all of Israel, and just about the time that David thinks everything's going okay, he comes on the scene, and he pronounces himself in the 10th verse of the 15th chapter of 2 Samuel, Absalom sent spies through all the tribes of Israel, saying, as soon as you hear the sound of the trumpet, then ye shall say, Absalom reigneth in Hebron. Now, Hebron is down here in southern Judah. It's south of Jerusalem, and David is up here in Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem, let me see if I can find us a map. It's going to be easier to find. Flip over here. We ought to find. I'll find it here in a minute. Hold on. Okay, here's Hebron right here. Here's Hebron. And here's Jerusalem. So here's Jerusalem right here. You're nearly at the top. Notice where you are because this is very important. Here's the Dead Sea. Here's the Sea of Galilee. Here's the Jordan River that comes down and empties in the Sea of Galilee. And if you're right at the top of the Dead Sea, just go down, just angle down slightly, and there's Jerusalem. David is in Jerusalem, king of all of Israel. And down here in Hebron, this is where Absalom declares himself king, takes over the armies, and he heads north, and he's going to go up here and declare war and try to kill his father and take him out and execute him and ascend the throne of Israel. Well, he has got a conspiracy going with Ahithophel. Ahithophel was David's counselor. He was the man that David would go to when the White House has a White House staff, and the president has got a White House counselor. He's got a chief counselor in the White House, the man he trusts more than anyone else. And that's the man he goes to. Well, Ahithophel was David's confidant. He was the man that David would say, Ahithophel, what do you think we need to do about this army coming in here? And he'd say, well, I feel like we should do such and such and so. And this is the man that David put trust in. And in the 55th chapter of Psalms, the 55th Psalms was written when David said, it was not thou mine enemy, it was my friend that was treacherous against me. We took sweet counsel together. Well, that psalm was written about Ahithophel. Now, I've had some Ahithophels in my life where I thought they were my friends. I thought some of my friend, and they started trying to overthrow. I've had several times in the church here, people trying to overthrow the church, saying, I'm your friend. Well, Ahithophel was David's counselor. And these are main characters in starting with the 15th chapter up through the 17th chapter. And I want you to, we have two priests. Ahimaaz, A-H-I-M-A-A-Z. Ahimaaz, this is another major character. You need to write this down. And then you have Abiathar. Now, these are two high priests. Now, Abiathar and Ahimaaz, why would you have two high priests? That is because Ahimaaz, his father was Zadok. Zadok. Now, the Sadducees say that they come from Zadok, Sadducees. The Sadducees didn't believe in a resurrection, and they say that they go back. Now, we know that Zadok was a righteous man, and the Sadducees were unrighteous. Well, they may have evolved from that and become apostate, but they said Zadok was the, and the word Zadok comes from Zadik. Zadik is the word good over there, and it was good over there in Genesis, the first chapter. T-S-Y-D-D-A-Q, I believe. T-S-Y-D-D-A-Q, I believe that's the way you spell it. Zadik. Well, the word Zadok comes from that, and the word Sadducee comes from the word Zadok. Well, Zadok was the high priest under Saul's reign. Now, a high priest had to come from Aaron. Aaron. It had to come from Aaron's family. Well, Ahimaaz, he was a high priest during, he was following David, and his father was Zadok. And when David conquered northern Israel, it would not seem like a righteous thing to put down this high priest, Zadok, and his bloodlines. But David had become close to Abiathar because Abiathar, well, that's A-R, excuse me. I've got E-R, A-R. Abiathar's father was Ahimelech. Ahimelech. Ahimelech, you remember he was the high priest over in, if you go over the 22nd chapter of 1 Samuel, he was the high priest. In fact, look at the 20th chapter. When David is running from Saul over in the 19th chapter, and Saul puts the word out on David, we want David to die. David runs, flees to Naoth, which is the house of the priests, and he goes there, and when he's there, he is taken in by Ahimelech, and of course, when David, well, excuse me, over here in, excuse me, in 21st chapter, when David, then came David to Nob, to Ahimelech, the priest, and Ahimelech was afraid at the meeting of David and said unto him, why art thou alone and no man is with thee? And David is running for his life from Saul. Well, David kind of tricks Ahimelech to give it to feeding him, and Doeg, the head of Saul's, the chief head of his herdsmen is there, and Doeg is the man is just a killer. He's a murdering spying for Saul, and we see Ahimelech, and when David leaves and he knows that Saul's men are coming, well, Ahimelech and all of the priests of God are killed in this 22nd chapter, and the only man that survives is Abiathar. That's the only man that survives. 85 priests of God are slain by Doeg and Saul in the 22nd chapter of 1 Samuel. David feels responsible for the death of Abiathar's father. Both of these men, Abiathar and Zadok, come from the lineage of Aaron. Both of these men, Abiathar and Zadok. Well, Ahimaaz is the son of Zadok. So David couldn't remove the lineage of Zadok because even though that was during the reign of Saul, these were still righteous, godly high priests. And then Abiathar, David has the heart for Abiathar because he feels responsible for the death of Ahimelech and those 85 priests because he went up there and had Ahimelech give him bread. And when Doeg and Saul come back and they ask Ahimelech, "Did you feed David?" And they said, "Yes, we did." And Saul tells all of his footmen, "Fall upon these priests and kill them." Well, the Israelites, by that 22nd chapter of 1 Samuel, they had had their fill, and they said, "We're not going to kill him." And the Edomite Doeg said, "I'll kill these priests." And that was the greatest slaughter of priests throughout the Scripture. So David feels responsible for the death of Abiathar's father. And Abiathar is the only priest. There were 85 of them killed, and this is the only survivor. So David says, "I'm going to preserve Abiathar and make him the priest." So when David had southern Judah, and Saul was ruling in northern Israel, Saul's high priest was Zadok, and David's priest was Abiathar. But after Saul is dead, it would seem unrighteous for either one of these men to be put down. So in the 15th chapter of 2 Samuel, both of these men are serving as the high priests of Israel, Zadok and Abiathar. And when we get to the 15th chapter, these men are serving, but they've got two sons. Zadok's son is this man, Ahimaaz, A-H-I-M-A-A-Z. Ahimaaz and Abiathar's son is Jonathan. Now, Jonathan was a common name. We're not talking about Jonathan, the son of Saul, who's dead over here in the 31st chapter of 1 Samuel. Well, these two men, Absalom is trying to take over Israel. These two men are going to act as religious spies for David. Now, he's got one other character I want to introduce you to tonight. And this man's name is Hushai. Hushai is an older man. Hushai was more than just a counselor to David. Hushai was David's friend. And Hushai is ready to do anything that he needs to do to cause David to retain the kingdom. He doesn't care what it is. This man, he's an old man. It's believed he's very old. And he wants to flee with David. And David is up here in Jerusalem. And what David's going to do, he's going to run for his life. He is going to go up here by the dunes of the Dead Sea. All of these are sand dunes along here. He's going to go up here by the dunes of the Dead Sea. And he's going to try to ford the Jordan River and go over here beyond Jordan and run for his life, fleeing from his son Absalom. Absalom's coming from the south. He's coming from Hebron down here. There he is right there. Now here he is down here about somewhere close to the middle of the Dead Sea. And he's going to head north to Jerusalem. It looks like it's probably, they usually have a chart here, probably about 30 or 40 miles or 50 from Hebron up there. And he takes his armies and he heads towards David. Well, David goes out the east gate of Jerusalem, heads out through the Mount of Olives, and he heads up, and he's headed up towards these dunes, and he has to get the message, and he tells Ahimaaz and Jonathan, "I need to get the message from you that it's okay for us to ford the river up here. They're going to run over here and run for their life to get away from Absalom and Ahithophel, this great conspiracy." Well, we're going to see that Hushai says, "I will go back." He wants to go with David in this 15th chapter. Hushai said, "I'll follow you wherever you want to go, David." And David said, "No, you go back in the city. Absalom's not going to kill you. You're an old man." He tells Ahimaaz and Jonathan, you go back into Jerusalem with the king. David even calls Absalom king. He's not the king per se. He is only the king in the eyes of the people, but David is the king in God's eyes. So unofficially, Ahimaaz and Jonathan, they're going to pursue their office as priests of high priests of God, but they're going to go back into Jerusalem, and when Absalom gets there from Hebron, they're going to take the message to David if everything is okay for him to flee, and Hushai is going to stay in Jerusalem, and he's going to be a spy there for David and try to thwart the efforts of Absalom and Ahithophel. There's one other man down here. Let's look at him, Ittai. Ittai. You find him in this 15th chapter, and he is a Gittite. What that is, that's another name for the people of Gath. And he is a Philistine. He is in exile. Here's the land of the Philistines here. He's been exiled, this Ittai. Now, you remember when David lived with Achish, when Saul in 1 Samuel, gosh, it's a lot of stuff. When Saul over in 1 Samuel, when Saul was seeking David's life, he ran over here to Gath. Here's Gath up here. David went to the land of the Philistines and lived there. Ittai is probably a man that he met, and probably a guy who got real close to David, because in this 15th chapter, Ittai did something over here in the land of the Philistines to be cast out in exile, and he's come over here and he's living with David in Jerusalem, and he tells David, I'll follow you anywhere you want me to go. You remember Achish was the king of Gath, and evidently Ittai, when David went to live in Gath, Ittai is probably a previous friend of David. Let's kind of resume this. Let's go back over here. I want to read back through part of this 15th chapter so we can see these characters. Go back to verse 13. David is running for his life. Absalom is trying to ascend the throne. Well, let's read verse 12. And Absalom sent for Ahithophel, the Gilonite, and David's counselor. Ahithophel was David's counselor. And as we said, when David said we had sweet counsel together, we had sweet fellowship, and you were treacherous as a viper. You had words that were smoother than butter, Ahithophel. And from his city, even Gilo, while he offered sacrifices and the conspiracy was strong, for the people increased continually with Absalom because he was very popular and they all loved him. And there came a messenger to David saying, the hearts of the men of Israel are after Absalom. And David said unto all his servants that were with him at Jerusalem, arise and let us flee, for we shall not else escape from Absalom. Make speed, depart, lest he overtake us suddenly and bring evil upon us and smite the city with the edge of the sword. Now, Ahithophel was a type of Judas. He betrayed Christ. Ahithophel was one who would embrace David with a kiss. And Ahithophel was one, he also committed suicide like Judas did when all of their efforts were thwarted and they failed to overthrow the kingdom. And the king's servants said unto the king, behold, thy servants are ready to do whatsoever my lord the king shall appoint. And the king went forth and all his household after him. And the king left 10 women, which were concubines, to keep the house. And the king went forth of all the people after him and tarried in a place that was far off. And all his servants passed on beside him. And all the Kerethites, the Pelethites, all the Gittites, 600 men which came after him from Gath, passed on before the king. Remember, David spent a lot of time in Gath in 1 Samuel when he was fleeing, running for his life. And he had some men over there in Gath, which was the city northernmost among the Philistines. Then said the king to Ittai the Gittite, wherefore goest thou also with us? Return to thy place and abide with the king, for you're a stranger and you're exiled here. There's no need in you running for your life on a second exile. There's no need in you being exiled from Gath and being exiled from Jerusalem, from Absalom, who's trying to kill me. You don't need a whole world trying to kill you, Ittai. Now, Ittai was made a joint commander later on. In fact, I'll show you that right now. David must have put a lot of stock in Ittai. He must have been a friend that helped protect him when he was over there living with Achish in Gath over there in 1 Samuel. Let's look over here very quick. Look at the 18th chapter. I'll show you what he does with Ittai later on. He makes Ittai joint commanders with Joab and Abishai, his nephew. Look over here in the second verse. Well, let's look at the first verse of 2 Samuel 18. And David numbered the people that were with him and set captains of thousands and captains of hundreds over them. And David sent forth a third part of the people under the hand of Joab and a third part under the hand of Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, Joab's brother, and a third part under the hand of Ittai, the Gittite. This man was very trusted, even though he's a Philistine, and he was from Gath. David had lived with the Philistines. He had lived in Gath when he's fleeing the wrath of Saul in 1 Samuel. And evidently, this was a man who he had learned to trust, and he places him in part and as head of a third of his armies. And the king said unto the people, I will surely go forth with you myself also. Now go back over here to the 15th chapter, and let's finish looking at these men here. I read through this quickly last week, but I want us to take a little bit of time on this. Look at verse 20. Whereas, speaking to Ittai, thou camest but yesterday, should I this day make thee go up and down with us. Now you're over here, you're exiled over here, your king is throwing you out of Gath for some reason, and you're over here in Jerusalem, and here I am fixing to run for my life and run over the other side of Jordan, and here's my son after me, Absalom from Hebron, and here's your king from over here in Gath after you, and you're going to be running from two guys, and there's no need in you doing this, Ittai. Go back to Jerusalem and just be at peace with my son Absalom, and this thing will be over. Absalom's not interested in killing Ittai. He's not interested in killing these priests of God, Ahimaaz, and he's not interested in killing Jonathan. He's interested in getting David. If he can kill David, then he ascends the throne, and all these will be his subjects, including Ittai, including Ahimaaz, including Jonathan, including Hushai. Now, let's read on here. Where was I? 21? 20. Okay, let's read 20. Let me get me a drink of water. I hope this is not too confusing. We're going to try to cover this. All right, now. And whereas thou camest but yesterday, should I this day make thee go up and down, run up? I'm on the run again. Now, this is David's second time to be on the run for his life. The first time started in the 19th chapter of 1 Samuel when he runs from Saul. Saul is after him to kill him. The second time he is fleeing for his life is in 2 Samuel. It starts here in this 15th chapter. Remember, the 19th chapter of 1 Samuel is his first time to run for his life. 15th chapter of 2 Samuel when he takes off and he runs from his son Absalom. Absalom is trying to take over the kingdom and Ahithophel has conspired with him. Ahithophel is David's close counselor. He says, sing, I go whither I may, return thou and take back thy brethren. Mercy and truth be with thee. You don't have to run with me. Absalom's not going to kill you. And Ittai answered the king and said, as the Lord liveth, and as my Lord the king liveth. Now, what is a Philistine doing saying, as the Lord liveth? He must be a believer. Either that or, you remember over there in 1 Samuel 29. Look at 1 Samuel 29. Look at 1 Samuel 29. If he's not a believer, he's got his food, doesn't he? 1 Samuel 29, and look here in verse 6. Achish is the king of Gath that David lived with. And Achish really loved David. In fact, Achish wanted to take David to attack Saul. Of course, if he'd have taken David, David would have brought up the rear, and David would have sandwiched the Philistines in between him and Saul's armies. Then Achish called David and said unto him, surely as the Lord liveth. Achish was the king of Gath. Evidently, Ittai was a man that David had met while he was living with Achish while he was fleeing for his life from Saul. As the Lord liveth, thou hast been upright, and thy going out and thy coming in with me in the host is good in my sight. For I have not found evil in thee since the day of thy coming unto me, unto this day. Nevertheless, the Lord's favored thee not. He's talking about the lords of the Philistine didn't want David going in and fighting against Saul because the lords of the Philistines didn't trust David, and they had every right not to, because before David would have let the Philistines kill Saul, even though Saul was seeking his life, David would have defended Saul because David said he was the anointed of Israel. He said, if God wants him dead, God will kill him. I won't. David would have preserved him. Of course, Achish made him go back. So Achish, that David lived with in Gath, here's Gath one more time. Here it is up here. Achish was the king of Gath. Well, David's army, they're headed north up here to northern Israel to fight Saul over there. And that's when Achish said, the other princes of the Philistines won't let you go. You're going to have to go back home. So, of course, David goes back to Ziklag, to his home back home, and he gets the word there that Saul is killed. Now, where was I? Ittai answered the king, verse 21, and said, as the Lord liveth, and as my lord the king liveth, Ittai, this Philistine, is calling David his king. He says, surely as my lord the king liveth, surely in what place my lord the king shall be, whither in death or in life, even there also will I be with you. I will be your servant there. What a unbelievable, isn't this something? Here's a Philistine who loves David more than Absalom loves him. He said, wherever you go, I'll go, and if you die, I will die with you. He must have built quite a friendship with David when he was in Gath. And David said to Ittai, go and pass over. And Ittai the Gittite passed over, and all his men and all his little ones that were with him. And all the country wept with a loud voice, and all the people passed over. The king also himself passed over the brook Kidron. That's right. Here they are. Where they're headed. They're coming out of Jerusalem. The brook Kidron, you go out the east gate, and the brook Kidron is on the eastern side. They're headed out over the brook Kidron, and they're going to go up through the sand dunes of the Dead Sea, and they're going to cross over Jordan and run for their life over here in this land of Ammon over here. They're going to try to get away from Absalom and Ahithophel's treacherous deeds. And they pass over the brook Kidron, and all the people pass over toward the way of the wilderness. That's the wilderness where, when you're talking about wilderness, you're not talking about what we call wilderness. And as you're going up here, you head up here through Jericho. Jericho, they had a path up there that they called the Valley of the Shadow of Death. That's because you had so many highwaymen. It was a twisting road. There was a man, you remember the man that was on the way to Jericho, the Good Samaritan, and he fell among thieves? Well, this area up here was filled with thieves, and they were headed this way, and they were going to cross the Jordan River and ford the Jordan River and get away. So they cross the Kidron Valley, and they cross over, and Ittai goes with David. And verse 24, or 23, all the country, well, I read that. Verse 24, they pass over the brook Kidron, and all the people pass over toward the way to the wilderness. David is on the run for his life. And to Zadok also, and all the Levites were with him, bearing the Ark of the Covenant of God. Now, they had to take that out of Jerusalem and take the Ark with them. Usually, whenever they want to go on a journey, they would take the Ark of the Covenant because that's where God was. But David says, I don't need the Ark. God's going to judge me. If God's going to be with me, we don't need the Ark and we don't need the priests. God, I'm going to be on the run. I'm going to be moving fast. Take the ark back to Jerusalem. And they set down the ark of God, and Abiathar, remember Abiathar? Son of Ahimelech. He's the one. Ahimelech, David feels like he caused the death of Ahimelech. There, when Ahimelech fed him, and Saul and Doeg found out about it, and 85 priests were killed, including Ahimelech, Abiathar's father. So David makes Abiathar high priest of Israel when he's king of Israel. And of course, Saul had a high priest, and that was Zadok. Well, these two men have got sons, Jonathan and Ahimeaz, and Jonathan. And they're very main characters here. And they set down the ark of God, and Abiathar went up until all the people had done passing out of the city. They're going out the eastern gate. They're headed up to the wilderness, and they're running away from Absalom. He's coming from the south. Absalom has got these huge armies. And the king said unto Zadok, carry back the ark of God into the city. Take the ark back into Jerusalem. If I shall find favor in the eyes of the Lord, he will bring me again. If I am God's king, I won't need the ark to bring me back. God will do it. Take the ark back to the city. And show, he will show me both it and his habitation. And if he thus say, I have no delight in thee, if God condemns me, David said, the ark won't help me. And David feels guilty because he knows all of this is what Nathan said, the sword will never leave your house, and your son Absalom is trying to kill you, and he's attacking you from the south, and they're running out the east gate of the city, going over the brook Kidron, and heading up to the wilderness, and they're going to ford the Jordan River and run over into the wilderness and stay away from Absalom. Behold, if he thus say, I have no delight in thee, verse 26, if God says this, behold, here am I, let God do to me as seemeth good to him. If God wants to kill me, he will. But David is God's king. The king said unto Zadok the priest, you got two high priests, remember that, Zadok and Abiathar. Abiathar was David's high priest. He comes from the house of Aaron, and the high priest of Saul was Zadok, and this is one of the few times they've incorporated two high priests in Israel. The king said unto Zadok the priest, art thou not a seer? Return into the city in peace, and your two sons with you, Ahimaaz thy son, and Jonathan the son of Abiathar. I want you to go back in the city. And when the time comes, I'll get the word from these young men, and they will report to me, and they'll tell me how it fares with Absalom here. Verse 28, see, I will tarry in the plain of the wilderness until there come a word from you to certify me. Until I get the word, I'm going to be over here. They're headed out the gate of the city. Absalom's coming from the south. They get out just in time. If Absalom had caught him there with his armies, of course, Absalom couldn't catch him because David is God's king. So he heads out the eastern gate. He said, I'm going to go over here into the wilderness until I hear a word from Ahimaaz or Jonathan, these messengers. Well, Ahimaaz, we had one fast runner in Israel. You remember him? Asahel. Asahel was the brother. He was the brother of Joab and Abishai. Well, you got another fast runner. His name, he's one of the priests, Ahimaaz. In fact, I'll read that to you in a moment. And Zadok, verse 29. Zadok, therefore, and Abiathar carried the ark of God again to Jerusalem, and they waited there. And David said, I'm going over in the wilderness, and I'm going to wait from the word from Ahimaaz and Jonathan. Look over here in 18:27. We'll see as Ahimaaz comes to David. 18. Well, let's back up to verse 25. This is where David is getting the word. And the watchman cried and told the king, and the king said, if he is alone, and if there's a runner coming, there is tidings in his mouth. And he came apace and drew near, and the watchman saw another man running. And the watchman called unto the porter and said, behold, another man running alone. And the king said, he also bringeth good tidings. And the watchman said, methinketh the running of the foremost, the one that's running ahead of the other, is like the running of Ahimaaz, the son of Zadok. He's a priest. And the king said, he is a good man and cometh with good tidings. This is what David says. I'm going over to the wilderness and I'm going to wait for to see if Absalom is overthrown. Let's go back to that 15th chapter. Verse 30. And David went up by the ascent of Mount Olivet. It's actually the Mount of Olives. Olivet is a Latin word, and it's not actually in the text. David is running out of Jerusalem, and he crosses the Kidron Valley and goes to the Mount of Olives. Now, the rabbis said that David probably wrote, we know that he wrote the third psalm somewhere about this time. The third psalm is about his flight from Absalom. We know that the 55th chapter is about Ahithophel, his trusted friend who had treacherously betrayed him. And the third chapter, the writers tell us in this 15th chapter that the third psalm, some writers say as David left Jerusalem and crossed the Kidron Valley and he went up on the Olives, that this is where he wrote the third psalm, running for his life. Some say it was probably about the time he's up here fording the Jordan River, getting across the river, and while he is resting after fording the river, he sits down and he starts penning the third psalm. Let's look at the third psalm, because all of the psalms are either written about events in David's life, events in Moses' life, or events in Asaph's life. Some say that Jeremiah wrote some of them. That's not substantiated. But let's go to the third psalm. The third psalm, and I want us to look at this because it's important that as we go, that we see these things. Now, I've said this before, and I'm going to say it to you again, that the superscriptions of the Psalms are inspired. See right there where it says, a psalm of David when he fled from Absalom his son. That is in the text. When you take your interlinear Bible, let me do this. Let me get my interlinear out here. Get this out. My interlinear, and let's go to the second psalm. To the second, huh? Third psalm, excuse me. Go to the third psalm, and we'll just kind of read that under the... All right, Psalms 3. All right, Psalms 3, and here's the reading of it. A psalm right here. You can see that the superscription. Super means, it's the Latin word hooper, for the Greek word hooper. Remember hooper meaning above? It means an inscription that's written above the psalm. And if you look here, a psalm of David when he fled from before Absalom. There's the Hebrew text right there. So the superscriptions are inspired. The psalms are separated by the superscriptions, or the hooperscriptions, or the inscription written above the psalm. This is when he was fleeing Absalom. If he wrote this, it had to be sometime about the 15th chapter of 2 Samuel. Can you see that? That's pretty well understood, isn't it? Let's read this. Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Absalom, Ahithophel, they're trying to kill me. I love Absalom, my son. Amnon has raped my daughter, and my son Absalom has slain him, and Joab's giving me headaches, and all of these people out here, and they're trying to destroy me, Lord. Many are they that rise up against me. Many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for him in God. Absalom is saying, you don't have any help. I've got the great armies, and you're my father, and I'm going to kill you and take over the kingdom. But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory, and the lifter up of my head. What he's talking about is you lifted me up to be king and placed the crown on my head in 2 Samuel 2 and 4 when he's crowned king of Hebron, and 5 and 3 of 2 Samuel when he's crowned king of all Israel. To lift up the head concerning a king meant to make him king. He said, you did this. Now Absalom is trying to be king. I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill. I laid me down and slept. I awaked, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people. What Ahithophel proposes in that 17th chapter, to take 12,000 and attack David, and he is thwarted. He is undermined by David's old friend Hushai. Hushai tells Absalom, "Absalom, you know me. I've been around a long time. I've known your father. Your father's he's a mighty warrior, and these are mighty warriors with him. This advice of Ahithophel is not good." And Hushai is lying to Absalom to turn him away in that 17th chapter. "I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people that have set themselves against me round about. Arise, O Lord, save me." I know how David felt. Well, we've had enough people wanting to destroy this ministry from time to time from all over the country. Had a lot of them in Nashville. "O my God, for thou hast smitten all mine enemies upon the cheekbone. Thou hast broken the teeth of the ungodly. Salvation belongeth unto the Lord. Thy salvation is upon thy people. Selah." Think on these things. Weigh this. Now let's go back to the 15th chapter. That's where this was written. It was written concerning this flight. If you want to find out where the Psalms are written, look at the superscriptions. Now let's go back to the 15th chapter. Somewhere about the 30th verse on to the end of this chapter, David writes that third psalm. David went up by the ascent of the Mount of Olives. They've gone out the eastern gate over the Kidron Valley, and they're headed up north, running for the wilderness. And from the south is coming Absalom and the great armies. "And he wept as he went up and had his head covered, and he went barefoot." Barefoot meant to show greater mourning. "And all the people that was with him covered every man his head, and they went up weeping as they went up." Where are they going up? They're going up out of Jerusalem, headed up the coast there, and they're going north, and they're running away from Absalom, and they're trying to head for the wilderness. And if they can get in the wilderness is a place that you don't want to go with armies. And David and his 600 or so are headed out that way. "And one told David, saying, Ahithophel is among the conspirators with Absalom." And David is broken over this. And David said, "O Lord, I pray thee, turn the counsel of Ahithophel into foolishness. This is my counselor that I had sweet counsel with." I've prayed that prayer. There's nothing I love more than this ministry. And anyone who tries to overthrow it, I say, God, destroy that man. "And it came to pass that when David was come up to the top of the mount where he worshiped God, behold, Hushai," David's friend. Hushai was an intimate advisor to David. Look at 1 Chronicles. Look at 1 Chronicles 27. Go to 1 Chronicles 27. We'll look at this Hushai. 1 Chronicles 27. Now, when you're reading Samuel and the Kings, you have to go to Chronicles to verify these things. In 1 Chronicles 27 and verse 33, "And Ahithophel was the king's counselor, and Hushai the Archite was the king's companion." He was the friend of David, the man that David would go and get him and say, "Hushai, I'm going on a little journey out here. I need some company. Would you go with me? I like having you along. You're my friend." "And after Ahithophel was Jehoiada the son of Benaiah and Abiathar, and the general of the king's army was Joab." So Hushai was David's friend. He was a man who accompanied wherever he was going. And he was trying to thwart the plots of Ahithophel. Now Hushai was an older man. "Behold, Hushai the Archite came to meet David, and with his coat rent." That meant he was mourning over this. An older man, and earth was upon his head, a sign of mourning. "And unto whom David said, If thou passest on with me, then thou shalt be a burden unto me." First of all, you're an old man. I need you back in Jerusalem more. I need you to stay back here to see what Absalom and Ahithophel are up to. He really trusted Hushai. Hushai was close to David. He said, "You stay here, but if thou return to the city and say unto Absalom, I will be thy servant O king, as I have been my father's servant. David is putting him up. Now, David's fixing to put his life in jeopardy. But he was saying, you can be more advantage to me there. But Hushai is willing to do this. Now, Hushai is going to, he's either going to have to run with David. If he runs with David, it's going to be hard on an old man. But he said, you can do more good for me back here and trying to bring this counsel of Absalom Ahithophel to nothing. I will be that. Tell the king, I'll be your servant. You notice what David calls Absalom, O king. He's not the righteous king. He's not the anointed king. He said, just go ahead, admit he's king and put a little con on him. He said, but if thou return to the city and say unto Absalom, I will be thy servant, O king, as I have been thy father's servant hitherto, so will I now also be thy servant. Then mayest thou for me defeat the counsel of Ahithophel. I'm going to need you here to help defeat his counsel in Jerusalem. We're running. You stay here. And hast thou not there with thee Zadok and Abiathar the priests? You'll have friends there. Absalom will trust them. He will not harm you. Give him some bad counsel. Therefore it shall be that what things soever thou shalt hear out of the king's house, thou shalt tell it to Zadok and Abiathar the priest. Behold, they have there with them their two sons. And they'll come and tell me, Ahimaaz, Zadok's son, and Jonathan, Abiathar's son, and by them ye shall send unto me everything that you hear through these two sons, Ahimaaz and Jonathan, the sons of Zadok and Abiathar. So Hushai, David's friend. Boy, I like that. David needs a friend right now, doesn't he? David's friend came into the city, and Absalom came into Jerusalem. And about the time Hushai gets back to the city, here's David fleeing north. He says, Hushai, go back to the city. So Hushai comes back and heads back to Jerusalem this way, and Absalom's coming up, and they come into the city of Jerusalem at the same time. Now, David is on the run. Chapter 16. David was a little past the top of the hill. Behold, Ziba. You remember Ziba? Ziba was the servant of Saul. Ziba was the slave of Saul. And when Saul died, he took over all of the property of Saul. And it was Ziba that David took the properties from Ziba and gave it to Mephibosheth. You remember that? He said, is there any left of the house of Jonathan or the house of Saul? And they said, there's one Mephibosheth. And when Ziba came in, he said, Ziba, this is not yours. This belongs to Mephibosheth. And he gave all the properties back to Mephibosheth. But Ziba, he gets involved in his treachery too. We put him up on the board here a while ago as one of the principal characters in here. Ziba is going to try to lie and steal back what he thinks has been taken from him, and that was the inheritance of Saul, and he's going to lie about Mephibosheth. Let's read here. When David was a little past the top of the hill, the Mount of Olives, Ziba, the servant of Mephibosheth, met him with a couple of asses saddled, and upon them 200 loaves of bread, and 100 bunches of raisins, and 100 of summer fruits, and a bottle of wine. Now, I believe Ziba has more in mind than just feeding David. I believe Ziba has got some treachery in his mind. He's going to try to steal back what's not his. And, of course, David is very nervous, and David's ready just about to believe anything. I've had some upheaval in the ministry. A lot of times when I'm real nervous and upset, I'm just about ready to believe anything. And that's what David's ready to do. And Ziba spins a tale to him. And the king said unto Ziba, what meanest thou by these? And David's running. They're headed north. Headed to the sand dunes of the Dead Sea. Going to ford the Jordan River and get over in the wilderness. And stay there until these two sons of Abiathar and Zadok, Ahimaaz and Jonathan come and give him the word that everything is okay for him to come back. What meanest thou by these? And Ziba said, the asses be for the king's household to ride on, and the bread and summer fruit for the young men to eat, and the wine that such as be faint in the wilderness may drink. And the king said, and where is thy master's son? Now, who was Ziba's master? Saul. And who was Saul's son? Jonathan. And who's Jonathan's son? Mephibosheth. He's saying, where is Mephibosheth? It's what he's saying. And Ziba said unto the king, behold, he abideth at Jerusalem, for he said, he starts spinning a tale here, because Mephibosheth knows he has a place at David's table as long as he lives. He knows he has no place with Absalom. And he knows he cannot fight Absalom. He's crippled in both of his feet. And Absalom is a great, mighty warrior. And he actually, Ziba spins this tale and he says, Mephibosheth is at Jerusalem, and he said, today shall the house of Israel restore me the kingdom of my father. Do you actually be Mephibosheth, who is crippled in both feet, believes that the kingdom is going to restore to him when Absalom is the son of David and he thinks it belongs to him and he's a fighter and Mephibosheth is not? No, he's lying here. Ziba is lying. He's wanting to get back. Well, what he does to catch David at a low moment, and he's out here. David said, I'll give you back all of these lands. Yes, I'm on your side, David. Ziba was out there for whatever he could get. Then said the king to Ziba, behold, thine are all that pertaineth unto Mephibosheth. He didn't even go and find out if it was true, did he? And Ziba said, I humbly beseech thee that I may find grace in thy sight, my lord, O king. It's about money. When people start lying, it's about money and power. And that's what Ziba was doing. There's no way that Mephibosheth would have ever believed that he could have come up against Absalom and Ahithophel. He didn't have any armies. Besides that, Absalom was the son of David. Are we fool enough to believe that Mephibosheth believed that Absalom was going to take over the kingdom and give it to him? No, Absalom's given. Everyone knew the ambition of Absalom, including Mephibosheth. And David said, as long as Mephibosheth lives, he will sit at my table and eat at my table. Don't you believe that about Absalom? Absalom will care nothing about Mephibosheth. If Absalom takes over, he'll kill Mephibosheth. And when King David came to Bahurim, behold, thence came out a man of the family of the house of Saul. Here we are. Shimei enters the scene. We didn't put him down, did we, a while ago? Shimei. Here's the man. Here's the man that throws rocks at David. And when King David came to Bahurim, behold, thence came out a man of the family of the house of Saul, whose name was Shimei, the son of Gerar. He came forth and cursed still as he came. And he cast stones at David and at all the servants of King David. Why is he doing this? David doesn't have an army with him. David is on the run. And here he is throwing stones at David as he's going north, and he knows that Absalom is coming in from the south, and he's going to try to destroy David, and Shimei feels safe. But he doesn't understand. He's throwing stones at the man of God, and David may have committed adultery and murder, but God has forgiven him, and these people think they can have a freedom to take the revenge of God. God has forgiven David. And this man is going to take the revenge for what he says, that David stole the kingdom of Saul. Saul wasn't God's anointed king. God turned down Saul there in the 15th chapter of 1 Samuel. He said, go to the house of Jesse. I have chosen me a king among his sons. And it was David. And he cast stones at David, verse 6. And at all the servants of King David, he's standing out here on a hillside throwing stones at him, cussing him, screaming at him. And all the people and all the mighty men were on the right hand and on his left. And thus said Shimei, when he cursed, come out, thou bloody man, thou son of Belial, David. That was the real common slanderous words to say that they used in that day and time. The Lord hath returned upon thee all the blood of the house of Saul. He was blaming David for the death of Saul and the death of the sons of Saul, in whose stead thou hast reigned. He's saying, you're reigning in the place of Saul. This man evidently didn't know the law of God that the king had to come out of Judah. Saul was of the tribe of Benjamin. And the Lord hath delivered the kingdom unto the hand of Absalom thy son. And David's heart is broken, and he could care less about this man throwing stones and kicking dust at him and screaming and cussing at him and yelling. Behold, thou art taken in thy mischief because thou art a bloody man with all the people you've killed. And here's Abishai, David's nephew, standing to his right, saying, Uncle David, I'll take this dead dog's head off. And David's saying, look, you sons of Zerah, and evidently Joab is in agreement with him because David looks over at him and he says, you sons of Zerah, what do I have to do with you? Don't you know my son Absalom is trying to destroy me? What do I care about this man throwing stones at me? God has bidden him to throw stones. Shut up, Abishai. David said, my heart is broken. This man Shimei means nothing to me. David said, besides that, I deserve the stones that he throws. I deserve every stone that men throw at me, but you better watch out, because if I am the preacher of God, remember the fate of Shimei. He died. David felt too guilty to have anything done to him while he was alive. But he goes and presents Shimei to his son Solomon. There's two things he gave to Solomon. There's two things that David gave to Solomon. One of the things was Joab, and the other was Shimei. And he felt too guilty to kill. He felt too guilty to kill Joab because he's the one that hired Joab to kill Uriah the Hittite, and then Joab goes on killing sprees every time he turns around. He feels guilty about Shimei because he said, I deserve this, and the Lord has bidden him to throw stones at me. Let's read on down through this. Then said Abishai, the son of Zerah, unto the king, why should this dead dog curse my lord the king? Let me go over, I pray thee, I will take off his head. Now, Abishai was a pretty tough nephew. Killed 300 men. He was a man to be reckoned with. He handled part of David's armies along with his brother Joab. Let's just look at these men one more time. I keep taking you back to the, let's go over here to the First Chronicles. I keep, for those of y'all that haven't been reminded of this, go to First Chronicles, second chapter. We see the lineage of David. And each time David says, these sons of Zerai are too hard for me, Zerai was his sister. And the sons of Zerai that he talks about is Joab and Abishai. Here in 2nd chapter, down here in verse 12, Boaz begat Obed, Obed begat Jesse. Jesse was David's father. Jesse begat his firstborn Eliab. That's the one that Samuel thought was going to be king when God said, go down to the house of Jesse because he was tall and handsome and a warrior in Saul's army. And Abinadab the second and Shema the third and Nethaneel the fourth and Redai the fifth and Ozam the sixth. David was the seventh son of Jesse, and whose sisters were Zeruiah and Abigail, and the sons of Zeruiah, David's sister, Abishai, Joab, Asahel, three sons. Asahel is dead at this point. He was killed by Abner in the second chapter. And the two men that are alive and well traveling with David, and Abishai was just always wanting to kill somebody. You remember over in the first, in 1 Samuel, in the 26th chapter, David caught Saul in a trench, and God had caused a great sleep to come over Saul while Saul was chasing David. And Abishai comes out there and says,
Uncle David, we got Saul here. I'll run him through the spirit. Let me kill him.
David's old Abishai. You're giving me a headache. If God wants him dead, God anoint him and God will make him dead in battle. Shut up. Abishai was a big mouth, running his mouth all the time, and he was tough. He was a guy you didn't want to run across and get in a fight with. Verse 10, the king said, what have I to do with you, you sons of Zeruiah? He said that again. Look over at 19 and 22. Go to 19. Go to 19. David was just frustrated with these guys. 19 and 21. But Abishai the son of Zeruiah answered and said, shall not Shimei be put to death for this, because he cursed the Lord's anointed? And David said, what have I to do with you, you sons of Zeruiah? Do you think I'm king and I don't know what to be done? I feel guilty enough as it is for my sin. And God has bidden this Shimei to throw stones at me. If God bid him to throw stones at me, I'm not going to put him to death for what God told him to do. That you should this day be adversaries to me. Abishai and Joab are just giving David a fit. I think that's a sword in the hand of God, isn't it? These two guys, they are a headache. Shall there be any man be put to death this day in Israel? For do not I know that I am this day? Do I not know that I am king? What is wrong with you guys? Abishai is always called, Uncle David, you like to kill this guy? I'll kill this guy. Do you think I'm king of Israel? I don't know what's going on. You have to be told by your nephew who's a hothead. And that's what he's telling them. David has some conviction, and all they're thinking about, you know how far Abishai can see? About that far. Hey, let's get in a fight today. That's what he wanted to do. That's his whole life. His life's about fighting, and Joab's is about power. Back to 16. The king said, what have I to do with you, you sons of my sister Zeruiah? You're just constantly intruding into my business. I'm the king. I know what needs to be done. I talk to God. You don't talk to nothing but yourselves. So let him curse, because the Lord has said unto him, curse David. Now, a lot of people, God's told you to curse Jim Brown. I'm not going to fight my battles. I'm not going to defend myself. I'm going to say, God, bring their purposes to naught. Their treacherous ways destroy them, God. Who shall then say, wherefore hast thou done this? If I do that, people are going to say, why did you do this? You said it was God that bid him to throw those stones at you. And David said to Abishai and to all his servants, behold, my son, which came forth out of my bowels, seeks my life. Absalom's after me, trying to kill me. I'm running for my life, and you're concerned about whether this man is going to be killed or not for cursing me. How much more now may this Benjamite do it? Let him alone. Let him curse. For the Lord hath bidden him, and God will deal with him. It may be that the Lord will look on mine affliction, and that the Lord will requite me good for his cursing this day. David said, the time will come when God will take care of him. And as David and his men went by the way, Shimei went along the hillside over against him and cursed as he went and threw stones at him and cast dust. And the king and all the people that were with him came weary and refreshed themselves. And Absalom back to the south, Absalom and all the people, the men of Israel, came to Jerusalem. And Ahithophel, the treacherous traitor, comes with him. This is happening. Here's David going. David is headed north, and somewhere up here, headed towards the Jordan, this Benjamite, Shimei, is throwing stones at David. And Absalom's coming in from the south, coming into Jerusalem. And it came to And Absalom and all the people of Israel came to Jerusalem, and Ahithophel with him. And it came to pass when Hushai, the friend of David, the Archite, remember we introduced him over here in that 32nd verse, when he told David, I'll go with you. And David said, no, you're too old. You'll be a burden to me. Go back in Jerusalem. I need you there. And when you can find out the plans of Ahithophel, and you can find out the plans of Absalom, then you get the word to Abiathar, and you get the word to Zadok, and they'll get the word to their sons, to Jonathan, and they'll get the words to Ahimeaz, and they'll be runners, and they'll come up to me in the wilderness, and they'll tell me when things are okay. And Absalom said unto Hushai, Absalom knew who Hushai was. He was his father's dear friend. He said, Hushai, why aren't you running with your friend, my father? Absalom doesn't want to kill Hushai. He's an old man. But he doesn't know he's there to overthrow his plans against his friend David. And Absalom is so cocksure of himself, he doesn't think that Hushai can do any danger, any harm. And Absalom said to Hushai, is this thy kindness to thy friend David, my father? Why wentest thou not with thy friend David up north, who's running from me? I'm going to be king. Why don't you go with him? I thought you loved him. And Hushai said unto Absalom, nay. And notice the truth in this statement. Nay, but whom the Lord and this people and all the men of Israel choose, his will I be. And with him will I abide. But Hushai knows who that is. He knows that is David. He said, no, I'm in Jerusalem, and whoever God and the people chooses to be king over Israel, that's who I will follow. If it's you, I'll follow you. But inside, Hushai knows that it is not Absalom. And again, whom should I serve? Should I not serve in the presence of his son? He's putting a little bit of con on him right here, isn't he? He's wanting to get close to him because he wants Absalom to take his advice in the next chapter when he tells him not to listen to Ahithophel. And again, whom shall I serve? Should I not serve in the presence of his son, as I have served in thy father's presence, so will I be in thy presence. I was a friend and advisor to him. I will be to you. If God wants you to be king, I will be. But I don't think that's going to happen. Then said Absalom to Ahithophel, David's counselor, who has so easily betrayed David, give counsel among you what we shall do. Then said Absalom to Ahithophel, give counsel among you what we shall do. And Ahithophel said unto Absalom, this is where he gives the first advice to Absalom. And this is the advice when Nathan over there in that 12th chapter says in verse 11, I will take thy wives before thine eyes and give them unto thy neighbor, and he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of the sun. Now here's Absalom in Jerusalem with David's harem. And David's gone, and all of his wives are there. And he says to him, that's why David's not there to stop him. And God said, I'm going to cause your neighbor to lie with your wives and have sexual relations with them in the eyes of the people in Jerusalem because you have laid with this woman. And Ahithophel said unto Absalom, go in unto thy father's concubines, which he hath left to keep the house, and all Israel, while he is fleeing north, shall hear that thou hast abhorred thy father. Then shall the hands of all that are with thee be strong. Ahithophel is sealing his doom. There is no turning back now. If David comes back, this man, his purposes are brought to naught. And he knows this. So they spread Absalom a tent upon the top of the house of David, and Absalom went in unto his father's concubines in the sight of all Israel. And the prophecy of Nathan comes to pass about David's wives. And the counsel of Ahithophel, this is the same thing that the man was doing in the 5th chapter of 1 Corinthians, wasn't it? Having an affair with his stepmother. Absalom was having an affair with his stepmothers. And the counsel of Ahithophel, which he counseled in those days, was as if a man had inquired at the oracle of God. And was all the counsel of Ahithophel, both with David and with Absalom. Ahithophel is a man you can't trust. He's counseling David, and then he goes and gives evil counsel to Absalom. Let me give you this. Let me just show you this. I want you to look over here at 1 Kings 2. Go to 1 Kings 2. And this is the demise of. Now here's David at the end of his life. He's turned the throne over to Solomon. And he says, I'm going to bring these two men to you. Let's read in chapter 2, verse 1. Now the days of David drew nigh that he should die. And he charged Solomon his son, saying, I go the way of all the earth. What does that mean? All men die. Be thou strong, therefore, and show thyself a man. He's telling Solomon, keep the charge of the Lord thy God to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes and his commandments and his judgments and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, that thou mayest prosper in all that thou doest, whithersoever thou turnest thyself, that the Lord may continue his word, which he spake concerning me, saying, if thy children take heed to their way, to walk before me in truth with all their heart and with all their soul, there shall not fail thee, said he, a man on the throne of Israel. Did the throne of Israel fail? Finally, yes it did, because they didn't walk in the way of God. Moreover, David says to Solomon, thou knowest also what Joab, the son of Zeruiah, did to me, and what he did to the two captains of the host of Israel, Abner, Saul's commander. He murdered him, the son of Ner, and unto Amasa, when I tried to make him general, he murdered him. This is my other nephew, by my sister Abigail. The son of Jether, whom he slew, and shed the blood of war in peace, and put the blood of war upon his girdle, that was about his loins, and in his shoes that were on his feet. And he goes through here, and he says, do therefore according to thy wisdom, and let not his forehead, his white hair, go down to the grave in peace. I don't want him to die an honorable death. David couldn't kill Joab, so he said, I'm turning you over to him, and I don't want him to die an old age peaceful death. I want you to execute him, son. I never could, because I hired him to kill Uriah the Hittite. But show kindness unto the sons of Barzillai, the Gileadite, and let them be those that eat at thy table, for so they came to me when I fled because of Absalom thy brother. And behold, thou hast with thee Shimei, the son of Gera, the Benjamite of Bahurim, which cursed me with a grievous curse in the day when I went to Mahanaim, and I was running for my life from Absalom. But he came down to meet me at the Jordan, and I swear to him by the Lord, saying, I will not put thee to death with the sword. Now therefore hold him not guiltless, for thou art a wise man, and knowest what thou oughtest to do with him. But his forehead, his gray hair, bring thou down to the grave with blood. You're going to have to kill him too, son. The two men he didn't know what to do with, Joab and Shimei, the one who threw stones at him there in the 16th chapter. He said, I don't know what to do with him. I'm going to give him to you. Execute both of them. Verse 28, then tidings came to Joab. For Joab had turned after Adonijah instead of Solomon. He picked the wrong man. Adonijah was the son of David, but Solomon was the son that received the throne. And David goes to Solomon, and he tells him, I'm giving you Joab. Besides that, he's been treacherous to you. He's been treacherous to me. He tried to overthrow you when you ascended the throne. Though he turned not after Absalom, he turned to Adonijah. It doesn't make any sense, does it? And Joab fled into the tabernacle of the Lord and caught hold on the horns of the altar. The horns of the altar, that was... Here's the tabernacle, here's the veil, here's the Ark of the Covenant. South side was the candlesticks, the altar of incense, the table of showbread. Here's the brazen sea, and here's the altar. The altar had little horns on it. If you could get a hold of the horns, the horns of the altar was sanctuary. Joab ran in and grabbed hold of the horns. It was sanctuary to accept everybody except a murderer. Well, was he a murderer? I guess he was. He'd killed Amasa, and he'd murdered Abner, and he'd murdered Uriah. The man was devious, underhanded, liar, murdered Absalom. And he grabbed hold of the horns of the altar. It was told King Solomon that Joab fled into the tabernacle of the Lord, and behold, he is by the altar. Then Solomon sent Benaiah, his commander, his chief, the son of Jehoiada, saying, go and kill him, Benaiah. This is the end of Joab, the pill that David had to swallow every day that he lived. And Benaiah came to the tabernacle of the Lord and said unto him, thus saith the king, Joab, come forth. And he said, no, but if I die, I'll die here. And Benaiah brought the king word again, saying, thus saith Joab, and thus he answered me. And the king said unto him, do what he says, kill him there, and fall upon him and bury him, that thou mayest take away the innocent blood which Joab shed from me and from the house of my father. Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, and God in his own time, just as Jezebel thought she could get by with murdering Naboth 13 years later, Jehu went to Jezreel and killed the woman. You don't get by. One thing you don't get by, coming up against the truth of God. And the Lord shall return his blood upon his own head, who fell upon two men more righteous and better than he, talking about Amasa and Abner. He murdered Amasa and Abner, these two men. And they're better than he is, and they're more righteous than he is. And slew them with the sword, and my father David, not knowing thereof, to wit, Abner the son of Ner, captain of the host of Israel, and Amasa the son of Jether, captain of the host of Judah, their blood shall therefore return upon the head of Joab and upon the head of his seed forever, but upon David and upon his seed and upon his house and upon his throne shall there be peace forever from the Lord. So Benaiah the son of Jehoiada went up and fell upon Joab and killed him. He slew him, and he was buried in his own house in the wilderness. And the king put Benaiah the son of Jehoiada in his room over the host, and Zadok the priest did the king put in the room of Abiathar. Now Abiathar, remember Abiathar? High priest under David. He took the wrong side in this too. Boy, it seems like everybody turned from David. And the only reason that Solomon spared Abiathar's life when he went after Adonijah, he followed Adonijah, David's son. The only reason that Solomon spared his life was because David felt guilty for having felt like he had killed those priests over there in that 22nd chapter, 1 Samuel. And Solomon spared him. And the king sent and called for Shimei, the one that throws stones at David in 16th chapter, and said unto him, build thee a house in Jerusalem. Solomon tells Shimei, come here, Shimei. Build a house in Jerusalem and don't leave Jerusalem. The day you leave, you die. And dwell there and go not forth thence any whither. Don't you leave Jerusalem. I want my eye on you. For it shall be that on the day that you go out and pass over the brook Kidron, you go out the eastern gate and you go out to Kidron Valley, you're going to die. Thou shalt know for certain that thou shalt surely die. Thy blood shall be upon thine head. And Shimei said unto the king, said unto Solomon, the saying is good, as my lord the king has said. Here's the man that threw stones at his father. So will thy servant do. And Shimei dwelt in Jerusalem many days. And it came to pass at the end of 3 years. 3 years has passed, and he's kind of forgotten, right? He's forgotten. He thinks it's not important. That two of the servants of Shimei ran away unto Achish, son of Maacah, king of Gath. And they told Shimei, saying, behold, thy servants be in Gath. And Shimei arose and saddled his ass and went to Gath to Achish to seek his servants. You remember, Achish was the friend of David. And Shimei went and brought his servants from Gath. And it was told Solomon that Shimei had gone from Jerusalem to Gath and was come again. And the king sent and called for Shimei and said unto him, did I not make thee to swear by the Lord that you wouldn't leave? And protested unto thee, saying, know for certain on the day that thou goest out and walkest abroad any whither, that thou shalt surely die. And thou saidest unto me, the word that I have heard is good. Why then hast thou not kept the oath of the Lord and the commandment that I have charged thee with? The king said, moreover to Shimei, thou knowest all the wickedness of thine heart is privy to that thou didst to David my father. Therefore the Lord shall return thy wickedness upon thine own head. And King Solomon shall be blessed, and the throne of David shall be established before the Lord forever. So the king commanded Benaiah, his general, the son of Jehoiada, which went out, and fell upon him that he died, and the kingdom was established in the hand of Solomon. He got rid of the last enemy of David. And that was the man who threw stones at him. So watch out when you start throwing stones at the Lord's anointed. And I warn people of that because there's people that have thrown stones at me. I am a sinner. But you better watch out what you do to the anointed of God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your truth. Thank you for the picture of David's life. What a sad story, Lord, to see how we don't need to be living. But David surely wrote these psalms about his life. And this. Thank you for the picture of the trials of David so we know what to do in this life to call upon you and rely upon you. And as David didn't defend himself, we turn our enemies over to you. God, deliver us and cause anything that would come up against this ministry, Lord, destroy and confuse their efforts. And we'll give you praise for all things. In Jesus' name, amen.